I am very happy to be here, and just as the formalities were quite justifiably and understandably short, I would like to make my introductory remarks short. I am aware that I have a mixed audience here, and some of you may be able to easily get into what I'm discussing and some may have difficulty. So instead of saying many other things, I would simply like to present a simplified version of my main topic first and then give you some of the evidence that will be an academic discussion of what the late K.D. Sethna wrote. Almost for 120 years or so, there have been off and on discussions of the starting point of dating things in Indian history. The main problem that was felt in the beginning was how to connect the traditional Indian time reckonings, usually found in the form of Shaka and Samvat, with the Western chronology, which has by default become a sort of universal common era chronology, and we refer to BC and AD or AC, and try to relate everything to the birth time of Jesus the Christ. The practical necessity is of course there. Unless we find a way of justifiably correlating the dates in Shaka and Samvat specifications to the Christian era datings, we will not be able to relate Indian history with the rest history of the rest of the world. That is absolutely understandable, and we should not think of treat this topic in any nationalistic way or anything like that. There is a universal international group of scholars, and we need to have one common reference point. Generally, it has been supposed that the Vikram Samvat dating is older, and it corresponds to 57, 58, 56 BC, roughly 56 to 58 BC. The Vikram Samvat datings in Indian tradition correspond to those in Christian datings. And it is thought that the Shaka dating starts at about 76 AD. Okay? So these are taken as dating starting points. And it is thought that the foundation for these, for the whole effort to be justified, is the dating of king or emperor Ashoka. Why Ashoka? Because that was the only dating found in earlier records which mentioned some Yona or Yavana kings. There were five Yona or Yavana kings mentioned, and those could be located in ancient Near Eastern records, ancient Greek records, and so on. And scholars thought that since the datings of those Yona or Yavana rulers were fixed, there was no reason to doubt them. If they are mentioned in Ashoka's record, then Ashoka must have been, in a rough sense, their contemporary, which is a very commonsensical way of doing things. So if you have a document that you can ascribe to Ashoka, that document mentions certain Yavana kings who are fortunately also found in non-Indian, Near Eastern or classical Greek records, then Ashoka must have been a contemporary. And if Ashoka's dating is thus fixed, then the rest of the Indian chronology is fixed. That is, that was the way, because otherwise there is no comparable handle on the situation. This handle was acknowledged first time in the late 18th century with William Jones, considering he was not aware of Ashokan inscriptions. Those were not discovered then. But he was aware that certain Purana passages mentioned Ashoka and the Mauryas, and those Mauryas could be related to the classical authors. And especially one name, Sandrakotus, was found, and this Sandrakotus sounded like Chandragupta in Sanskrit. So the time of Sandrakotus should somehow be the time of Chandragupta. And William Jones, therefore, simply took that as a rough indication of the dating of Chandragupta's descendants also. That is, they could be removed from him only by 25, 30 years or so, as children are from fathers and grandfathers and so on. Thus, at least some kind of sense could be made of Indian records. Otherwise, it would be anarchy in chronology. That is why William Jones was first attracted to this possibility. And what the kind of correspondence he established between Chandragupta Maurya and Chandragupta Sandrakotus of the classical European tradition became a very definite point for Indian historians, historians of India, I should say. That was taken as settled. And later on, the discovery of Ashokan inscriptions, which mentioned the Yona or Yavana kings, was simply taken as a very important, unchallengeable corroboration. And almost all the history of ancient India has been written with trust in this kind of correspondence. As I said, there were scholars who were uneasy with this for a long time. And right from 1890s or so, you have scholars saying, there's something wrong with this. There is something not quite convincing about this. But all of these wrote in small articles here and there. Their idiom was, how can our Puranas be wrong? How can the traditional Indian Kali Yuga idea be wrong? This was the time, this was the type of attack they had. And so, especially from South India, Swaminatha Kannu, his work on Indian calendar and astronomy and so on, he tried to say that, no, the Indian tradition is much older than what this synchronism of Sandrakotus and Chandragupta would convey to us. And then there was one T.S. Narayana Shastri, who was associated with the Kanchi Mutt. He was a lawyer by profession, and he was one of the first few authors to write. He also expressed doubt, but he wrote about the king Sri Harsha or Harsha in the Indian tradition. And he tried to date the Sri Harsha of Kanauj to a much earlier time. It was a small pamphlet. It was an MA thesis of his, about 20 pages, that was published, and it's very difficult to locate it. I have come across several summaries of it, but I still haven't put my hands on the original document. Unfortunately, Madras University itself does not have a record of his thesis, so it's a very sad situation. But I may locate one of these days a copy. Anyway, a lot of summaries of his view are available. Then there were several other efforts. It was not until K.D. Sethna tackled the problem that we really had a very good case made for questioning the synchronism that William Jones had established. So Sethna wrote this book, Ancient India in a New Light. This is the second edition of this book, about 600 pages. And he considered the issue thoroughly. He wrote in a very professional manner, very dignified kind of English language, so excellent command of the English language, and with due respect to professional historians, so-called mainstream historians, and so on. Then also he wrote another book in there, which some articles which are relevant to this, Problems of Ancient India. There may are other a few scattered pieces as well. The reaction of the academic world does not do any credit to the academic world. I am an academic. I have spent my more than 50 years in academic life in India and outside. But I must say I am ashamed of my colleagues, the way they have treated scholarship of this life. That you can say we are not convinced. You can say I object to this argument or that argument. You can carry the discussion forward. That is understandable. The intellectuals, discussions, debates, disagreements are very healthy and they should take place. But simple non-recognition, non-acknowledgement of a book is absolutely to be condemned, and especially of this kind of book. And what were the reasons some of my colleagues gave? They say it's a Hindutva book. They say it's written by a Hindu who thinks that everything in India must be older than anything else in any other part of the world. This is an attempt to give primacy to the Indian tradition, and a blind kind of pride in the tradition. And if you ask them, have you read the book? In a few minutes, it becomes obvious that they did not. This is injustice to a scholar. I do not agree with Sethna entirely, but I do respect the effort and I do acknowledge the fact that he has come up with several good arguments. And what I'm going to say is that he is essentially correct. He is justifiably on the right path. I am going to give what I consider to be a slightly better argument than he did. Slightly better because my argument is going to be directly philological, directly requiring no second-hand interpretation or anything like that, and because it's corroborated by several other indirect pieces of evidence, some of which may come from Sethna, some of which would be additional pieces. This is the general orientation of what I am going to say. Now, let's go a little deeper into it. Although most academics say that the connection established by William Jones is unchallengeable, there's no need to change it, those who say this haven't really looked at Jones's writings in full. That's another thing. Jones himself wavered a great deal. First of all, he put Ashoka in 15th, 16th century BC. And if I say that date, I'm not going to champion that date, but if I give any date like that, I will be laughed at in the academy right now. They have done it, but I'm not going to be disturbed by it. I've never been disturbed by such things in the past. What I do is I go to famous universities of the world and I present the case. If they have been impervious to something what they should have read a long time ago, I invite them to come and give the other side. So I have spoken on this issue at University of Marburg, I have spoken at Hamburg, I have spoken at School of Oriental and African Studies in University of London, at University of Kyoto, wherever colleagues were willing to listen, where they're open-minded, where they had heard me on other topics, and they at least were 1% certain that Ashok Aklujkar is not going to put forward some nonsense in front of them. So it will not be entirely a waste of time. So they listened, and there could be another 3 or 4 universities. One university where I have colleagues whom I respect for several other things, but where my offer to give a free lecture has never received a positive response is Harvard University, my own alma mater. And that's where it's interesting. So this is the academic world, there are good people and bad people in the academic community as anywhere else. So let it not disturb you, but it should lead you to consider whether our universities really serve the larger interests of the community. Whether we have more conservative and die-hard academics sticking to certain views, or whether we have truly open-minded academics who would say, okay, well, at least we'll note the arguments, that we'll read the book. We will say, not convinced, that's fine. But if we have people who simply are like a big rock, no matter how much you water you pour on it, it's never softened, then there is something wrong with our social institutions. That's the main idea. Now, as I said, William Jones himself never expressed that great deal of confidence, but the conclusion he favored in his time, every historian has a right to be influenced by his or her time, to be influenced by it. It's human after all. But he showed preference for a later date for Ashoka. And what was his argument? His argument was that the Puranas have internal inconsistencies. That someone will put a distance of 25 years between Ashoka's grandfather and Ashoka. Some another source will put 35 years, you know, of distance. And therefore, he said, let me go to that chronology which agrees with the Western sources. That was his reasoning, basically. So the statement that academic or mainstream historians frequently make, that William Jones has once and for all, for eternity to come, fixed the synchronism. He's done it beautifully. There's no reason to challenge him. They themselves don't know that Jones himself is not really so entirely committed to one hypothesis. It is true if he had openly said that maybe future research will change this, or maybe others would like the other alternative. If he had openly said that, things would have been easy. But later academics should at least be smart enough to see that he did consider two alternatives. And if he chose one, we need to examine the other one. You know, after 200 years, if we can't do that, then what are we paid for? Right? You know, that is the real situation here. The discovery of Ashokan inscriptions referred to the five Yona kings or Yavana kings, and since their dates were taken as fixed, K.D. Sethna's main focus in this book is to point out that there were kings with similar names or identical names about 600 years earlier in the Near Eastern tradition. And his line of attack on the Jonesian position is how could you be sure that the earlier kings are not mentioned here and only the ones that are closer to 3rd century, 4th century BC are taken? That is the main line of attack he has. He invests a great deal of energy and a large number of pages to point that out as a possibility. And after entertaining that possibility, he comes up with a conclusion. By the way, yes, I will read from the handout copy I have, but if the handout arrives in time, you can check it. What he said was that of these Yona kings, one is uncertain, the other has problems, the other, we know really nothing about the other. Such difficulties he pointed out, in effect. And he said the synchronism with five is really not as strong as it is usually taken to be. And he said it's just coincidence that we have essentially a constellation of five kings mentioned with a temporal gap of 600 years in between. And when he appealed to coincidence, in my view, he weakened his argument. That is, he had found out certain other things, but no historian is going to take this coincidence of five kings separated from each other by 500, 600 years to be just a coincidence. And if they say it's just coincidence, then for as a historical piece of evidence, it's not strong. That would be the line. How do you prove that other possibilities are ruled out and only coincidence remains? So using word like coincidence is like admitting the weakness of one's evidence, although the details Sethna had were quite good details. Now, what I'm going to do instead is to point out that these inscriptions themselves are not contemporary. The inscriptions are not contemporary, and I'm going to point out with the internal evidence of the inscriptions. The inscriptions are the oldest objective evidence we have. If they themselves should indicate that they do not belong to Ashoka's time, that they have been inscribed, that they have been carved on stones, etc., 500, much later than Ashoka, then we are in a good situation. Then why a difference of 600 years? Those who are familiar generally with Indian history will know that there were two dynasties, the Maurya dynasty and the Gupta dynasty. And both had Chandragupta. In fact, there are three Chandraguptas recognized in the dynastic lists of the Puranas and others, especially of other sources. Well, Puranas don't talk about the Guptas, which is again a very interesting thing that Sethna has highlighted. Puranas take Guptas as the end of their domain. That is, they are not going to speak beyond the Guptas. They speak of a time when the Guptas are about to rise on the scene, but they do not speak of individual Gupta kings. So, first the Chandragupta Maurya, the Maurya dynasty is said to have come after the Nanda dynasty. That's quite clear from the Vishnu Purana and other Puranas. And then we have beginning roughly around the Christian era, Gupta dynasty, which lasted until about 320 AD. So roughly 300 to 400 years are given to the Gupta dynasty. That Gupta dynasty had a founder, Chandragupta, whom we nowadays refer to as Chandragupta I. And then he had a son, and followed by a son whose name was Samudragupta, and then Samudragupta had a son named after Chandragupta I, whom we call Chandragupta II. It's very common in many parts of India to name a person after the grandfather, especially if the grandfather is no more. You know, that's the way of commemorating the ancestors. And so we have in all three Chandraguptas, Chandragupta Maurya, Chandragupta I of the Gupta dynasty, Chandragupta II, grandson of Chandragupta I. Okay, so that is the situation. And Sethna's argument is that it is Chandragupta I that is meant by the historians of Alexander. Historians of Alexander who speak of Chandrakotus, they are really referring to Chandragupta I of the Gupta dynasty. And all other historians have so far taken that reference to the Chandragupta of the Maurya dynasty. Now, between the Mauryas and the Guptas, there is a distance of 600 years, roughly speaking. So if you change the identification of Chandrakotus, you push all dates in Indian political history, dynastic history, back by 600 years. That's why I'm referring to 500 years, 600 years. If you say, why are you talking in such large numbers, generally 500, 700, 600 years, why don't you give me very precise datings? And the only answer is, as we go back in time, the means to decide something decisively, very precisely, go on diminishing. Fewer and fewer sources are surviving in the tradition, so we should not be very dogmatic about 580 or 579 or something like that. We can just determine in terms of probabilities, and as long as the probability is supported by objective pieces of evidence, preferably contemporary, and there are several pieces of evidence generally pointing in the same direction, we should be satisfied in the case of ancient history. So in some cases, we will have definite precise dates. In some cases, we will have approximate but very defensible dates, and we should create a chronological frame. Do we have any alternative to a chronological frame? No. Without a chronological frame, history cannot be written. And if a country doesn't have this sense of history, it doesn't have a future. That's quite in practical terms. So, you know, if a distinctive culture like India's is to have a history or a future, it has to have a history. And history without this chronological frame would be like a picture without a frame. You know, can you imagine? A picture has to have boundaries. Picture has to have some lines covering it. And so we have no alternative. We have to have some chronology, but in some cases we will have only probable chronology. And as long as that is objectively supported, that is supported by many sources, independent sources pointing in generally the same direction, we are on the right track and we should be satisfied. So that's why 500 and 600 years would be the pushing back of the history. Now, since Ashoka's dating is the sheet anchor of Indian chronology, is the foundation stone, without it we cannot connect Indian history to outside traditions, outside datings, we have to to say that everything that we have arranged so far for the first few centuries of the Christian era and for the pre-Christian eras before the Mauryas changes. Everything goes back. That is, as long as there will be other pieces of evidence too, the Upanishads, the time of the Buddha, time of Mahavira, all this will go back and everything will be affected. Particularly, directly affected will be the dating of the Buddha, and then through the dating of the Buddha, dating of Mahavira. So this is our gigantic consequences. These will have consequences also for world history. That is, if the Buddha is... Ashoka is pushed back by 500, 600 years, the Buddha will no longer be 480 BC as Professor Gombrich would have it now, but this would be about 1000 BC. You know, and since Ashoka is said to be either 100 years after the Buddha or 218 years after the Buddha, this kind of consequence cannot be avoided. This is quite an objective, precise date given in the Sri Lankan chronicles preserved in Pali. So the consequence will be unavoidable. And generally we believed that Jainism is older than Buddhism. The founder Mahavira would then again be pushed back. We don't know by how much, but he will have to be older than the Buddha if the general thesis is right. So you see why Ashoka's dating is important and how doing it properly will have consequences. General prevailing bias, I would say, in world history is to take the Middle Eastern cultures as older. The culture of the pyramids is older. The culture of Achaemenid kings is older, especially of the Persian kings, whose Darius and Cyrus and others. So those datings may not be affected, but we'll have to reconsider them again and again and see if they are right. Do you get a sense of the enormity of the problem that we have? Okay, so that's the general background you all need to have. Now I'm going to get into some details. Ashoka's inscriptions is a wonderful phenomenon in world history. And by Ashoka's, I mean here, ascribed to Ashoka. I do not mean directly caused by Ashoka. Okay? He is responsible for them in an important sense, but he is, according to my reading, he is not the one who is saying, go ahead and carve these on the stones and so on. These inscriptions are large in number. Practically identical text is found in more than one inscription. They have two basic groups. One is called major rock inscriptions, and the other is called minor rock inscriptions. There is a third group, scholars call it special inscription or exceptional inscription or an inscription that was added as a variation at a later time. I don't get into it, but let me give you my conclusion. The special inscriptions are not really a distinct category. The special inscriptions should be included with minor rock inscriptions. Now, what is the difference between major rock inscriptions and minor rock inscriptions? The major rock inscriptions contain different edicts, different teachings, prescriptive sentences of Ashoka. And these sentences have really impressed the world, because for the first time in these sentences, we have a mighty emperor, obviously a very influential king, who is saying, in such and such case, I made a mistake. Have you, in world history, can you think of someone who will say, yes, that was a mistake, that I caused a war and I caused this much of violence, loss of life, I regret it. So it's a very unusual kind of powerful person you come across. Then he is saying, be respectful to the Brahmanas and Shramanas, take care of the animal lives, plant trees along the highways, make sure there are hospitals, take care of the aged people and the young people and so on. A very model of civil society, what we would call civil society, is present in these inscriptions. And therefore, it is not only one of the oldest set of documents, but it is a very different kind of document, where political power has no arrogance associated with, where political power has humane considerations associated with it, and that's why they are a valuable heritage of humanity. Now, in this situation, in the major inscriptions have about 13 or 14 edicts or rescripts or prescriptive sentences. And they are usually found in the same sequence in different on different surfaces. And the minor rock inscriptions are limited in scope. They seem to be addressed only to the Buddhist monks and Buddhist Sangha. They do not seem to be intended for subjects of a king in general. So that's the essential difference. The major inscriptions, until recently, it was thought that they do not show any variation, but critical editions have been made now of all of them, something that should have been done several decades ago, but everything has its time in history. Someone has to really do the hard work. And what a critical edition means, we try to see if there are versions, if there are regional differences, which one is more likely to be older and so on. That is the essence of critical edition. So we find some interesting differences. In one description, the king says, here, this should be observed, this should be done. In another instance, he refers to the Girinar Mountains. Okay, so just to give you an illustration. And then you ask, which one is likely to be older reading in this case? See, one can see why someone would change from here to Girinara, make what is general, more what is more specific. But is anyone likely to go from a very specific mention to a general mention? That is less likely, because, so obviously the Girinar inscription has to be somewhat later. Let's not get bogged down in such details, but you have to have some idea of what is involved. So a critical edition now exists, and they basically came to the conclusion that there are two versions of these inscriptions, where the order of the recommendations is the same, the wording is essentially the same, but minor significant variations are found, but significant only in being more particular or more general, nothing more than that. So the variations are not such as will shake the earth, shake our understanding of Ashoka. Similarly, in minor inscriptions, they have found out the language of the minor inscriptions is on the whole older than of the major inscriptions. These are the findings. The study of these inscriptions has been carried out in French, German, Hindi, Pali, in all kinds of variations. The corresponding documents have been produced It's a very significant body of literature. If I were to include all of it, it will probably rise up to this level, different critical studies. And also scholars all over the world have been wondering about it, this working on this. Some very gifted linguists like K.R. Norman, they have tackled questions and so on. Now, on the whole, we understand these inscriptions. There is no big question of interpretation left here. A few minor words remain obscure, few places where we don't know what the text or really wanted to read or say. That's true, but nothing of great significance remains unexplained. What are the strange things? The strange thing is that the name of the author, an author in the sense of person responsible, the force behind these inscriptions, Ashoka, is nowhere mentioned in the major inscriptions. We just have two epithets, Devanam Priya and Priyadarshi. You know, I'm giving you the Sanskrit renderings of these, Devanam Priya and Priyadarshi. Just these two occur. There is no name in the major inscriptions like Ashoka. Even early scholars were intrigued by this fact, and they tried to find who this Devanam Priya was, who this Priyadarshi was. There are at least 6 or 7 very renowned scholars who have written just on the word Devanam Priya. What does it mean? So we'll have to consider that. And Priyadarshi was not much of a problem. It obviously means one who wants good things for his people, one who looks after the well-being, that what is dear, you know, Priyadarshi, who looks after attractive, in an ethical and moral sense, attractive things, and that Priyadarshan, who sees the Priya, who sees the endearing element. So, the question is mainly about Devanam Priya. What is the significance? Why is the author not identifying himself personally? That's one thing. The second thing is, there are in all 14 sections of these major inscriptions, or we call 14 edicts of them. And the 14th is sometimes missing. In the 13th, we have a reference to the Yona kings, the ones I mentioned, 5 Yona kings, and they are given so all of you now have this piece of handout that I have created. So you will find that, under item 5, you will find the names of the Yona kings. Do you have a copy? You should have one. So, please share it here. So there are kings mentioned there, and their Greek equivalents, classical equivalents. Do you see that? You didn't get one either. Okay. And then the other, 13th, and then the 14th edict is not edict in the same sense as the earlier ones are. There, someone is saying that I made this collection of edicts over a large area, over from a kingdom, and it's found in various forms. Sometimes it's very short, sometimes it's middle sized, sometimes it's long, and I got them carved, and I will try to look for other inscriptions. That's the essence of it. The 13th, because it mentions the Yona kings, is important, and an echo of this 13th is found in the second edict, where it simply refers to Yona kings. Okay, so we have a general reference to Yona kings, and then we have listing of these Yona kings in the 13th one. And what Sri Sethna did was to consider all these things, and he tried to show that these Yona kings could be older. This could be older, and as I said, he discussed every case and went through a lot of literature, obviously. And ultimately he said, why select only the ones who belong to the 3rd and 4th century BC? Why not select some kings who are about 600 years older who would belong to the 9th century BC or so on, 8th century, 9th century BC. That was the tack, that was the line of argument that he took. Now, what I'm in the few minutes that I have, what I will try to show is, as I already said, if you say this is just coincidence, you weaken your argument. There is a better argument preserved. And for that, please look at just one thing. Yes, point 7 on the handout, item 7. So you have minor inscriptions alone that mention Ashoka. And one is a Nittur, the other is Udegolam, the third one is Muski, and fourth one is Gujarra. These are the places where these inscriptions are found. And there you have references. One says Raja Asoko Hevam Aha. Then another one which has a rather problematic sentence, unsteady reading. But Yatha Raja Asoko Aha Tatheti. Then Udegolam has Raja Asoko Devanam Piyo Hevam Apa, that is should be Aha. Maski has Devanam Piyasa Asokasa. And Gujarra has Devanam Piyasa Piyadasino Asoka Rajasa. So you have Ashoka mentioned. Scholars were delighted when they found the mention of Ashoka because they had now a definite identification of who this Devanam Priya was and who this Priyadarshi was. Before that, they had to remain independent on mention in Simhali's chronicles only. The jubilation is going on and is taken as a settled fact. But if, as a text-critical scholar, you look at it, you'll find that there is no steady form for mentioning Ashoka. And Ashoka is sort of inserted in these inscriptions. It doesn't come in the natural sequence. And obviously, it's an afterthought. Obviously, it is someone else was trying to preserve the tradition, preserve the information to whom these inscriptions belong. And that person has inserted, I'm not saying in recent times, this is not a modern scholar's forgery or anything like that, but ancient India had its historical awareness. It has preserved as much history as it could. Just because the history is very distant, many things get lost. But the charge that ancient Indians had no sense of history or anything is not true. That is, political history was very carefully preserved. Just because it extends over thousands of years, you have losses here and there, nothing more than that. So here, someone had this information that Devadatta, Piyadasi and others was Ashoka, and that has been mentioned here. And it was left to individual historically aware persons to insert this information. That's why you see the variation. It's significant that this is an unsteady way of identifying the author of the inscriptions, the inspiration behind the inscriptions, because in 6th century BC, in Persia, we have the inscriptions of Darius, and they all have a fixed formula. King Darius, son of son, such and such, and so on, he commands the following, he does the following, he conveys the following. It all comes in a stylistic form. So these insertions must be older than that. If the Indian inscribing was at all influenced by the Persian ones, that's how mainstream scholars generally think, then this is an older, unsteady formula where there's no fixed mention of the royal person behind. And the other thing is that the other elements in the inscriptions would go to Ashoka, but they would not go in the sense of Ashoka himself is telling someone, some local carver, carve these letters. This is a very naive kind of impression created by modern scholarship, as if Ashoka had nothing else to do but write these inscriptions. And therefore, anytime he finds a sort of bad spelling somewhere, he goes there and says, correct it. Now, these inscriptions are spread all over from Takshashila to Tamil Nadu. So imagine here, and in old days with forests and means of communication so few, Can you imagine a king and who is really not self-asserting, that much self-asserting, going to places and saying, carve this correctly? Are the messages really unheard of in the Indian tradition? That's not the case. We may find them very unusual in the case of a mighty ruler, but these are the ideas that are the essence of the Indian tradition that are frequently repeated. In any civil conversation, these ideas are put forward. So there is no reason for him to be worried about the correct transmission of his ideas, but there is reason for him to assure his people that these are my ideals and try to follow. That one can understand. There is need for that. But are these thoughts original to him? He doesn't say so. And especially the Buddha, whom he definitely knew, had said these things a lot of times. So that explanation doesn't make sense. What we have, I'm going to summarize here now, is yes, there were documents, probably in Ashoka's archives or the archives of the Maurya dynasty, where these records about what Ashoka said at various times were made. Someone later thought that we should have these in a firmer form, more definite form. The effort went through two or three different stages. First of all, maybe individual inscriptions were done. Then an effort, a second batch, where several such edicts were combined, and we got these major rock inscriptions. And they also went through a lot of trial and error effort and so on. And this is what happens in the case of manuscripts. It's a very common phenomenon in the case of Indic manuscripts. The same thing has happened here, only the medium of writing is different. That is one thing. Now this brings us to some questions for which Ashokan scholarship has still not given satisfactory answers. One is, why are these inscriptions mainly found in Brahmi all over the subcontinent? Is there any other instance of the same writing, same message being carved over such large areas? Why is the script generally steady? Yes, there are Greek inscriptions of Ashoka and Aramaic inscriptions, one or two here or there in the extreme northwest. But they are specifically addressed to the Greek residents, Greek rulers of those provinces. So over the rest of the country, over the country that was not influenced by Iran or Persia, you have generally steady script and no change. And interesting is, was this common script current over India in such an old time? That's one thing. Was the people's ability to read so common that Ashoka could simply carve something and leave it to the people to read and be influenced by them? Very unlikely. Most of India was very wise, very well informed, but it was bahu shrutata, not bahu patitata. People through the kathas, kirtanas, other social media, people got extremely abstract truths very easily in an entertaining way. They had gurus, they had different types of educational institutions. And until recently, India was not short of education at all. So you can see that Ashoka did not have to inscribe something and assume that people would be familiar with the same script at such an early age, and they will all of him, even in Tamil Nadu, they would read Brahmi script and so on, which we have not been able to do in modern times. So how would he be able to do that? So there are very curious things scholars have simply glossed over in their enthusiasm for a very noble emperor and for their love of Buddhism and other things. But scholarship should not be naive. Scholars should not be simplistic. You have to write to raise all questions. And they may be disturbing, but you have to consider them. And so this is one thing. Why, found in such a large area? The next thing is this identical text in over large area would be imaginable if there was a royal decree or something. But where would Ashoka get the manpower to go all of these things? And if he had this intention, would he not write it in a place where people can easily go and read? Suppose you have a grama panchayat, and in front of you, you erect a board, as we do in many Indian villages even now, that tomorrow there will be meeting, or tomorrow such and such teacher will be giving a sermon. People go and read, that's possible. most of these inscriptions are at odd places where one cannot even read them. So one is in a cave where there is no light. Another one is which could have been inscribed only if the carver stood on two different rocks, big rocks, and carved on top. If the idea was people going by the highways of ancient India should easily read them, they would have been at the right place. They are not even at the famous places of pilgrimage. Even as recently as 1970s, an inscription was found in a jungle near Nagpur, a small minor inscription. So obviously, these were done by individuals. They admired a king, they had his record, but it was their urge, their inner empathy for this king that led them to carving these things. And then, who were these? You know, these were the people, probably Buddhist monks, Jain monks, Ajivikas and others, who were wandering from place to place. Why would they value these? And they value these to the extent of keeping the same script. So we have a stage where even writing has acquired a value of religious merit. This is very common in India. That is, in Jainism, for example, and this was true of Brahmanism too earlier, that is, if you copy an ancient manuscript, you get punya. This is a meritorious act. So someone is doing this for meritorious act, for being helpful to society, of course, but getting personal merit also. And the script has earned the same status, the same value as murtis have, as icons have. That is, by doing them in a specific way, you are creating an object of worship, object of respect. This explains several things that modern scholarship have left unanswered, unexplained. And we get finally to Devanam Priya. As I said, 7 or 8 scholars have written on it. One thing has been missed. And in Indian tradition, Devanam Priya, we say, if someone is dear to gods, dear to divinities, and that person is snatched from among us, that person dies, then we say God found him very likable, we're fond of him. That's why they have taken him from among us. This is the simple explanation you find in the Indian tradition. Except for that, all other things have been attributed to this word by scholars. Now, what is the implication? If we have Devanam Priya occurring in all the inscriptions, almost all of them, especially in major edicts, they have probably been carved after Ashoka left this world. That he is a memorable king, he is a memorable ruler, he is being remembered. And this is a tradition that started, which is authentic in the sense that its inspiration goes back to Ashoka, the thoughts go back to Ashoka. In that sense, it's Ashoka. But it's not Ashokan in the sense of providing a state's backing for all these carvings and so on. Now you will see that once we what happens to the mention of the Yona kings, that will be my last point. The Yona kings mention gives us the lower limit for these inscriptions. The inscriptions could not have been carved after 320 BC or so. They could not have been later than that. That's roughly 300 BC. That is the date for Yona kings. And since they are mentioned, the inscriptions must be coming after them, but not far, too far from them. So that is, it has to be contemporary in that sense. So inscriptions belong to one time. We don't have to rely on the mention of Yona kings to decide Ashoka's dating. There are several other independent pieces of that indicate that Ashoka must be older than these inscriptions. And this is also supported by the 14th edict, where someone is saying, this is a great area. I have to collect inscriptions from different parts. I'm giving you one list. I will make another effort sometime. This is not Ashoka saying. This is someone who is collecting these edicts. He's saying. And very natural. Even a modern scholar would say, for example, he was copying Mahabharata. He would say, I have given you as much of the text as I could find in my part of India. But if something new comes up, of course I will make an addition to it. It's as natural as that. So I hope I have made some sense, and thank you for listening to me patiently. I will of course be happy to answer questions later on.